Okay, today we will continue on the tender invitation notice itself. So here I have listed down what are the major things that needs to be there in the tender notice or tender invitation notice. So still again we have not, the topic is tender, but we are in the invitation process. I will show you a tender invitation notice today as an example, but let's find out that when you want to know the quotation of a particular object that you want to procure, or say you want to get a work executed, a construction work executed, so you want to know the what is going to be or who is going to build it, you want to assess that, so you want to find out who all are eligible as well as who all are eager to work, so you are asking them to submit quotation through a proper notice. So the information that you have to give in that tender invitation notice are mode of submitting tender, that means whether it should be submitted by post or by mail or it should be handed over. Okay, generally tenders are never handed over, the quotations are never handed over to a particular person, or it has to be submitted in a closed box which is kept in some office if it is invited from any office or and all. So the mode of submitting the tender has to be mentioned there. Next is form in which tender is to be submitted, that is in case you have a huge or big tender or a complicated construction project where you need multiple quotations from for different aspects, there if different bidders or tenderers, the people those who submit tender, gives their quotation in different formats, it would be very difficult to compare all those. For example, say you have given a description of work and somebody has given the price to get the work executed at some amount of money per square feet, some has given as is there an issue,
sir? The screen is not visible.
Screen is not visible. Okay, again I will share it. Is it visible now, Rohit?
No,
is it visible now?
No, sir.
Are you watching it in your mobile?
Yes, sir. It is visible now.
It is visible now.
Yes, sir.
So as I was saying that maybe the so Rohit, what you can also do is whenever I open a screen, you just take a screenshot of that. Okay, just tap to screenshot and keep it in your mobile. Okay, you can refer it to later. Just listen while referring. So form in which tender is to be submitted means that some quotation has been found that all the units are in feet, FPS unit. Some of them are found in SI unit, some of them are found in a mix unit, some of them have given a quotation that whatever you get executed, okay, I will do it in say 20 lakh rupees. Somebody has given a price for each and every object or construction works that you have given. Somebody has given not only of the construction works, but a detail of the laborers, transportation, clearing of waste, availability of electricity and water during construction, everything. So it would be very difficult to compare and find out who is the lowest bidder. So sometimes what we do is we give them the format and ask them to fill that format where all the units are mentioned. So it is easier for us later to compare that quotations of the tenders. Hence we take this generally give this form in which tender is to be submitted. Next is name of the inviting authority. So even if some person is inviting, it is always wise to give the name of the authority on behalf of whom we are inviting the tender. This actually attracts better bidders. For example, see, if I want to know the price of a desktop in market or price of a brick in market, I will ask for tender by giving this tender notice or tender invitation notice. But who will give me the cost? Why will they give me the price of that? But if I say that I am from say huge constructions, say Reliance constructions or L&T constructions, and then I need to know the price of one truckload of 1 ton, 10 tons of bricks or 20 tons of bricks of class one and all, even though I am the person who have invited the price or quotation, the bidders or the suppliers would be eager because they will now get a good business with a proper well-known authority. So you, on behalf of which authority you are inviting, has to be mentioned. It also helps in another way by like, say you want to purchase one or two products and you invited a tender invitation notice on behalf of another authority, a higher authority, and then you are doing the payments and all for personal benefits, for your home usage and all. So the price should have varied for the two, which is not varying right now because you have done something wrong. So always the name of the authority on behalf of whom a person is inviting the tender has to be mentioned there. Next is nature of the work and its situation. Briefly, you have to say what kind of work you expect them to do and where it has to be done. For example, a construction of a PWD government building in Surat, something like that, or supply of a XYZ material at Department of Planning and Architecture, NIT Rourkela, in this way. So that this again confines that who are the bidders who will be bidding. Somebody who doesn't sell this kind of product or doesn't provide this service will not be bidding. So the nature of the work and situation has to be mentioned. Next is estimated cost of work. So suppose you want to make a building of your own, a residence, and there can be a set of bidder like who can get the same work done at say 20 lakh rupees, and there would be some reputed person who will do the designs and all and get it executed at say 50 lakh rupees. So if you have your estimate of work, and you can by your estimate you mean you are going to pay say up to 20 lakh rupees, then maybe those high end bidders or high quality designers or suppliers or contractors will not bid because they cannot do that work within your estimate of work. Maybe somebody who has an experience at cost effective or low cost building construction will submit it. So rough estimate of cost has to be given, and this estimated or rough estimated, all of you know what is a rough estimation for sure by now. Okay, not a detailed estimate. Next is time limit. This time limit includes two aspects. Tentatively, when do you want to get the work started or a product delivered, and what is the span of time that you will allow them to work on? Okay, both of them, that defines the time limit, that from when till when you can get the work done. Next is the availability of data and forms. Now if we see the example here, the left hand side example at the bottom. Okay, I'm in the slide of open competition. At the bottom there is an example given by Indian Railways Institute of Electrical Engineering, Nasik Road. There is a tender notice. So it is mentioned that if there are any forms that will be given or any description of the job for which they have to bid the quotation and all, then website particular notice board is mentioned in here. So this links, if you click on, it will directly give the bidders the description of the product, that if they are using bricks or in this particular case electrical works and all, what are the specifications for which they have to give the quotations. Specifications, particularly the specifications, that means the availability of data for construction work, maybe the drawing, the architectural drawing or the working drawing that for which they would be giving the quotation, or the material, that means the specification that they need, they will find it from here. And any other form, that means the form in which tender has to be submitted, that link of that can also be given here. Okay, next, coming to the 8th, earnest money required with the tender. Now I have to explain what is an earnest money. So earnest money is, for example, say you have asked for a bid to get a building constructed on behalf of a particular authority. You have asked, you have given the estimated cost and all, where it has to be executed, what is the time when it has to be executed and all. Now you don't know that who all are going to bid for this. There may be a situation that somebody who has no intention of getting the work done, but just to improve the acquaintance with you, is submitting a tender. Even though he gets a contract letter, he is not capable to do. But he has came across your tender invitation. So he is giving a tender notice. So now, if you say that along with submission of the tender, you have to pay a caution money, commonly known as the earnest money. It shows that you are eager to get the work done once you get the contract. It is mentioned in this tender invitation and it is submitted along with the tender or along with the quotation. Is it clear? What is an earnest money?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Remember this term. There will be a lot of other monies which are going to be paid along with the tender. One of it is the earnest money. It shows the eagerness of the bidder to get the work done if he is given a tender. If he is given a contract letter. Now, the obvious question should be that if everyone is giving it in earnest money, and if one of them is given a contract, what happens to the money which you have received from the other? So the money of the other, except the second lowest bidder or maybe the third lowest bidder, is given back after the contract is signed with the first one. With the lowest bidder, once a contract is signed, the money is given back other than maybe the second lowest bidder. Why? Because after signing the contract with the first or the lowest bidder, after some time, if you feel that the work has not started yet and there was a fraud and something and you cannot make him work, so immediately you put off the contract, you terminate the contract and you fortify this earnest money. You keep the earnest money, you don't return it back. And immediately you give the second lowest bidder a chance that, okay, you gave a quotation which is still now valid. Are you interested to work again? If you are interested, we will come and sign a contract. Then if the contract is signed, he gets the contract. This earnest money is adjusted in the subsequent bills. This earnest money is adjusted in the subsequent bills that he is going to be paid. If not the first installment, maybe in the last installment. Okay.
Sir, so second bidder doesn't get to pay this earnest money again.
Everybody has to pay the earnest money along with the tender. For example, you have asked some of the bidders that you want to get a work done. So I am going to give a quotation. But if you want to know whether I am interested or not, or whether I am eager to actually do the work or not, you are asking me to also submit another amount of money with that, which is known as earnest money. Now, there are few competitors of mine. Say, I am the one with the lowest quotation. There is, say, Ram Sam, who has given the second lowest and the third lowest amount of money. So what you do is, you after the processing of the tender, you return back the money of the third lowest bidder. Say, Shyam ka money, you return back. And with me, you sign a contract. Okay. So once a contract is signed, in the contract, you are going to say how much money you are going to pay in each and every individual stages. You are not going to pay the total money together. So in any one of the bill, you are adjusting this earnest money. That means you are paying it back or you are adjusting that amount of money which the bidder might have to pay. Have you got it?
Yes, sir.
Yes, please. Yes.
So, like all these things will be like provided in the when we are off, when we are making that contract. Oh, sorry, the tender. When we are making the tender, we'll write all these things as like.
You are making a tender means you are giving a quotation. I am still now asking for a quotation. That means I am inviting a quotation. I am sending a letter to invite the quotation or to invite the tender. Tender is the price quotation which I have not received yet. So I am saying ki whenever you are submitting your tender, you also have to submit a required percentage of money of the estimate of cost, or say any say 5000 rupees or 1000 rupees as an earnest money. It only shows that you are eager to do. You are not some arrogant person who has just given a quotation for the sake of just giving a quotation. It shows your eagerness. Hence, the earnestness or the earnest money is the name. Now, this earnest money can later be converted. Either it can be adjusted or it can be converted into some other form of money, say caution money. Or say a money which is kept for any accidental use. Say during the work, some damage has happened and it has to be repaired. Now the contractor doesn't have the capability to repair it immediately. So you use this earnest money to get it repaired during the work. You need not give it back at during the work also. Even you can give this earnest money back after the completion of the work also. Have you got
yes,
it?
Sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Sir, that means it is not mandatory.
It is not always mandatory. For example, say you want to buy a small equipment, say a keyboard and a mouse, which hardly costs 1000 rupees, and you are inviting a tender. So somebody gives 900 rupees, somebody gives 1000 rupees, somebody gives 1100 rupees. For this, why again you have to ask for an earnest money? Because earnest money will be how much? Maximum 5%. So 50 rupees. Why do you have to get that 50 rupees again, pay back the 50 rupees to all these three bidders? So generally what happens is, in big scale project where jahan pe you need to know whether the bidder are genuine bidders, there only you ask for this earnest money. Okay, it is a kind of assurance or security that you are keeping with yourself. Okay, it is one of the different kinds of security deposit which we keep. There are multiple different kinds of security deposits. Earnest money is one of them. Now, earnest money is asked to be given while submitting the tender only. If it is asked, all the bidder has to give. So somebody who asked me that whether it is compulsory or not, if it is mentioned in the tender invitation notice, then everybody has to give. If somebody doesn't give, his tender or his quotation becomes invalid. Even though the information or quotation is correct, but since it was asked and he has not paid the earnest money. Okay, I will give you a good example where it happened. Have you all heard of this reconstruction of the parliament in New Delhi, which has come into market? That the parliament complex will be rebuilt.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
In the same precinct itself. Okay. So it was found that the government institute, probably PWD, who asked for the design and all, asked for something in form of this earnest money, which was beyond the annual turnover of 99% of the architectural firms of India. So out of every 100 architectural firms in India, only one architectural firm has a capability to pay that much amount of earnest money. So they are asking for, say, 1 crore rupees as an earnest money, which, see, it can be adjusted with the bill, perfect. But while submitting the tender, somebody has to have a 1 crore rupees bank balance. It is not possible to maintain a 1 crore rupees of bank balance by companies other than, say, Convindes office or maybe Hafiz contractor's office, or maybe some competitors from Dubai or Singapore, Shimuzu. So this shows, it was debated, it was put into the case that this amount of earnest money, whether it is 5 rupees or 1 crore rupees, that has been intentionally done so that some unwanted bidders cannot compete. And in that way, it was proved that this invitation was against the interest of Indian architects. So they had to modify the tender invitation notice again so that Indian architects can compete for this. Because earnest money has got nothing to do with the capability of the competitor. It depends on the eligibility, eagerness of the competitor. So I am asking you something, that whoever can submit a golden coin can only supply me the product. That means I am asking him to keep mortgage an amount of money which probably I am sure he will not have, but he might be capable to do the job. Okay, so earnest money is generally kept to a percentage or a round figure amount of money of the total project cost. Now, if you are asking for earnest money, you cannot just ask for the earnest money. You have to say for what purpose you are asking. That means the purpose for which the security is required, the character of the security. So whether the earnest money will be in terms of cash, in terms of a check, in terms of a mortgage building paper or a house paper or a plot paper, what we got. Suppose the contractor has a plot of land which he wants to mortgage. So the paper that he is the owner of this plot and all, he is keeping, he is submitting. That can also be done. Or you can also ask for his last 3 years or 6 years tax document. We need to know that he is a genuine taxpayer or not, and he is regular in maintaining his accounts or not. So that can also be earnest money. Earnest money doesn't have to be physical money or physical cash. So we say the character of the security. Is it clear? 8B. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. See, since I am sharing my desktop and not the presentation, in my screen, none of you are visible. So even if you raise your hand, I won't be able to see. I'm just seeing the presentation and talking to my webcam and my screen. So you can unmute at any point of time and ask the question in between. Okay. Next is the amount of the security for sure. How much amount you want to claim as keep as an earnest money. And then the return of deposits, that at what point of time, in which mode you are going to return this earnest money back. That also has to be mentioned during invitation of the tender notice. Okay. Next is the security deposits. Security deposit is something of a broad nature. It is like earnest money can be one of the different security deposits. Now, security deposit is something like, you can say that for generally it is done for bigger projects, particularly government projects. Again, to ask for the eagerness, as well as suppose the contractor has brought in a lot of laborers from a different state or district and is housing them at your site when the work is getting executed. Now, if there is any damage done to the site by those workers, how are you going to get it repaired or mend? Contractors ke saath jo contract hai usme, these things are not done. And that is the fault of the contractor also who is giving quotation. Or say you have asked for a equipment which is a sophisticated equipment. Now, if there is a damage that has happened during transportation of the equipment from the contractor side, this security deposit can be fortified. Okay. Or else, for example, say you get a house built in 2 to 3 years. A house requires 2 to 3 years to get built. Now, you are not building it in one day. It is taking 3 years maybe. So it might happen that the work that was executed on day one or day two, and by the time you get the total 3 years of work done, maybe the works which were done initially have started discoloring, or small cracks have started coming up and all. Small damages has been found, or small mistakes has been found. So they have to be rectified. And this rectifications criteria are not mentioned in the contract. So from where will you get the money to rectify those? Okay. Or it'll say, so at that point of time, the security deposit can be used. I say can be used because that for that particular thing, a different terminology is used. If all of you just keep in mind this term, it is known as defect liability period. So after the construction is completed, still the contractor is liable for repairing some small defects up to a particular time. So money against the defect liability period is different. It can be utilized from the security deposit, not always. Okay. Another thing is like, for example, say security deposit, need of security deposit, which I'm explaining again, that a situation is arising that you had signed a contract with a contractor, but after a particular work phase of work is done, the contractor terminates the contract, and you say, you also see that isse koi kaam nahi ho raha hai, let's get rid of him. So you drive him away, you pay him up to that particular amount that has been done, promised. But now in between the work, again you have to sign another contract with any other, and that may be a formal contract again. So you have to start contracting, or this paperwork from zero. the work may be starting from that 50%, 50-51% to the rest, but you have to do the paperwork from beginning, which will again incur some cost just because the previous contract was terminated in between. So that cost has to be brought in, and then by the time when the previous contractor started working and by the time when the new contract is being signed, value of money has appreciated. So again, you are not assured whether you will get the work done at the cost at which the contract with the previous one was signed. And now definitely the charges will be higher. So to compensate that high price, the security deposit can be fortified. Okay. So there are a lot of issues, but you have to mention, if these are not mentioned in this stage zero, which is tender invitation notice, then you cannot claim it at a later stage. There's a simple reason for putting it here. Next is for building construction, the 10th point for building construction, information regarding plan. So depending on at what kind of work you want to get done, you have to submit basic conceptual drawing or say architectural design or working drawing, or sometimes we call it shop drawing. Shop drawing is actually working drawing coupled with your specification. Okay, that is known as a shop drawing. That means that drawing is given to the shop or the dealers or the vendors or the suppliers of material, and seeing the drawing and the specification, they give their quotation. Okay, so all this information has to be given depending. Now, I have written plan. It can be any product which you are purchasing. So the information regarding that product or the detail of a product. You want to purchase a desktop. So information regarding the desktop, that means detailed specification of the desktop has to be given. Okay. And then three important things. You miss something. These are really three important things. Why I will explain later. But see, tender has to be submitted to the tender inviting authority. Now, by what time it should be submitted? So the last date, place and time of received of the sealed bids, S-E-A-L-E-D. That means it is closed. It cannot be open midway. That kind of bid has to be submitted. And this deadline is fixed. This is about the submission only. Okay. Because it might happen that, unlike your design assignments deadline, for sure, that you are given a deadline to submit the tender, which is say 14th of August 2020, which is this Friday. So what happens is, I have asked all 19 of you to submit a bid of that particular construction work. I have given you the design and all. All of you are individually submitting, and some student or some of you submitted by tonight or tomorrow night. But the last date of submission is say Friday evening. So suddenly something happens that on 14th is a Friday. So say on 13th or say on 14th morning, suddenly you see that pre-independence day bonuses are going on, or some discounts are going on, and you are able to procure something at a cheaper price. So whoever is submitting on the last date of submission, there is a chance that the price might decrease. If the price appreciate, no problem. You can still give at a lower price. But if the prices are low, because we are always aiming at becoming the lowest bidder. So preferably make sure that it reaches the destination on the last date, time and place. Please do not follow this in your design studios. Okay. Next is the date, time and place, as well as procedure of opening the tender. So submission date is okay. After that, basic scrutiny will be done and it will be opened as at a predetermined time, place and location. Okay, and I have said procedure because it can be a private opening of tender. It can be a public opening of tender. Generally, open tenders or open competitions are open in front of public. That means everybody is sure that their competitors' envelope is also open at the same time, and there is no intermediate change in the price, and nobody has seen your price before. So it is a fair chance of everyone. And the date, time and place. Why the date, time and place? Because those who have submitted the bid may also be present during opening of the tender. So that again, it is an unbiased approach. Everybody should know that, okay, whatever price I have quoted, that price is actually getting into competition. For example, say one of you, say roll number one has submitted a price and roll number two has submitted a price which is say 1 rupee is higher than rule number one, but I am a friend of rule number two. So what I did is, while opening it, I announced the price which is 2 rupees higher of rule number one. That means rule number two, though he has cited 1 rupees higher, is now announced as 1 rupees lower. So he is the lowest bidder. To avoid these conflicts, we have to set the date, time, place so that the bidders or the representative of the bidders or the tender submitting person, commonly known as tenderer, T-E-N-D-E-R-E-R, tenderer, can be present. And the last one is reservation of rights to reject bids. That means, since this is not a legal document or the quotation is also not a legal document, there you individual authority has the rights to reject the bid. Now, whether they will have, under what circumstances they will have, everything has to be mentioned in here, that the tender inviting authority has every right to reject bids, but with justification. You cannot just reject the lowest bidder citing that I have the reservation to reject, so I have arbitrarily rejected yours, though you are the lowest bidder. That cannot happen. Okay. But only the rights of rejecting the bid are to be kept with the tender inviting authority. So these are the 13 basic information. Now, depending on the scale of project and the complexity of the projects, this information in the tender notice can even go higher. It can also come down. But what I felt is these 13 are really important. Otherwise, if you miss one of them, then there is a chance of a loophole and the bidders will try to put a cap on top of your head and keep you blind. Okay.
Sir, I have one question.
Sure.
Sir, the tenderer, sir, if it is a large company, then I guess the officials of that company would be appointed as the tenderer.
That depends on the authority of the company itself, whether the manager will come, whether there will be a different department who does this tendering and submit this tendering and all. For example, say, on behalf of the institutes of NIT Raurkela and the Department of Planning and Architecture, the chairman of the department purchase committee floats tender or invites tender. On behalf of NIT Raurkela at the end.
Yes, sir.
The chairman of the Department of Planning and Architecture floats the tender because we don't have requisite staff who could have also done the same thing. So the bigger the company or the smaller the company, some person who has the authority to invite the tender on behalf of the company has to do it.
Okay.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Next is prerequisite for tendering. Okay. I am sure in this MS Teams itself, in the assignment or in this Teams, in the channel, this file has been shared. You can all download it. The PPTs you can download. The PDF has also been shared. You can download it. But prerequisites for tendering. Okay. So you have invited a tender. Just understand the situation. You have invited a tender. Tenders have come in and for building construction, and then you have opened it, you have compared it, and you have found who is the lowest bidder, and you are going to sign a contract. But you realize that there is a lot of dispute with the plot which has not been cleared yet, or your loan from the bank has not been cleared yet, or your drawing has not received the statutory clearance from the sanctioning authority till now. Initially, when you asked for a tender, you didn't wait for all these things to get completed, because these, unfortunately, this tender invitation and all are time consuming things. It delays the work. But after getting the tendering done and when you are going to sign a contract that you start the work from tomorrow, you find that there are a lot of things still pending. So for a client who is inviting a tender, there are a lot of things which is a prerequisite which you have to take care of before tendering. This doesn't need to be mentioned in the tender invitation notice. It is just for the understanding or clarity for the client. First is availability of a clear site free from legal and physical obstacle. Now, this thing, what I have done is I have introduced these points to keep the architecture student as well as the people interested in building construction interested. project management is a generic subject. I have tried to streamline it for the student of architecture. So I have said availability of clear sight free from legal or physical obstacles. Okay. Just like if you remember the movie of Khosla Ka Ghosla, you know what is meant by legal or physical obstacles. So they have to be clear of this. Next is adequate fund to make payment on time. That means if it is stage-wise payment or if it is a lump sum payment, you pay the money and at one go and just get the work done at the end. So do you have adequate fund or not? That you have to see. Finalization of designs and working drawings. So initially you have got the estimate from your architectural design or concept design. Now when the work starts, your working drawing and all other necessary detailed drawing has to be finalized. Statutory clearance to commence the work. That means from the relevant authority, the work you have to submit this good for construction drawing and it has to be approved from the municipality or municipal corporations or similar other authorities. That has to be done before you sign the contract. Next is procurement of materials stipulated for issue to the contractor. Now you have asked for a quotation regarding supply of manpower to get a work done. It happens when, say, you have already have a sanction for a two-storied building today, and today you have built only one story, depending on the money which you are capable to invest. So after 10 years, you plan, or say after 5 years, you plan that you have got a bit more money, you are able to save a bit more money, and you want to complete the second floor. But you have a lot of material left from the previous procurement. So if those are there, try to use those, as well as if you are only asking for labor cost and you are yourself a contractor, then you should be asking only for manpower and you are going to supply the equipments. You are going to supply the materials and the equipments. Only the manpower is going to come. It is a labor contract. You are signing in for the labors only. For example, say in my office, I want to get a fan installed. So what I do is I purchase a fan from the market and I pay the electrician. So the electrician comes up at a particular cost. He fix up the fan in my office. So I have to supply the material if that is not in the contract. Okay. Next is list of pre-qualified contractors. Which means that if you want to only know that whether the contractors who are going to bid are qualified enough to get the job done or not, you have to have the list of the qualified contractors or pre-qualified contractors. That means what should be the pre-qualified criteria. For example, in your institute of NIT Rourkela, if you want to get a work done, say today some problem has arrived, I will have to call somebody who is going to come and repair the system or get the electrical point repaired. So they already have completed some pre-qualification because they have submitted necessary documents to the institute and the institute have vetted through those, checked through those and given them a green signal. Okay, you are registered vendors. Okay, so these are pre-qualified, list of pre-qualified contractors. We all know that whom to contract in case when it arises. Next is completion of any other pre-contract activities specific to the site. Now, for that particular site, if there is any other pre-contract, for example, you want to start constructing foundation, so you also have a pre-contract, which is a contract for excavation of the site or leveling of the site. That has to be first completed and then laying of the foundation has to start. Next is free accessibility to the site for inspection. Now, you are asking for a quotation for a work to be done, a building construction work has to be done. So, the tenderers, the bidders, has to first visit the site and understand all the problems and then like physically site visit. That means a reconnaissance survey has to be done where the bidder will get to know, okay, what are the constraints and what are the advantages and disadvantages. He will do his own analysis and then only submit. So he should be given a free access to the site. Okay. For example, say you ask him to build a site on a small hillock and you covered up the whole site, he hasn't got any chance to inspect. And once the buildings and everything is sanctioned, a contract is signed, he enters and finds that there is already one floor or two floor basement of soil which has already been taken off. It is a water body. So that should not happen. So you should give him the free access for inspection before he submits the tender. So quickly, the prerequisite for tendering for the contractor. When a contractor is going to submit a tender, before that he should check something. The tenderer should look into something. Those are site visit for a familiarization, market survey of material, labor and machinery. These are very simple languages. Seed money to commence the work. So initially what he does is the bidder, once he get a contract, he spends the money and he reimburses it from the client. So whether he has the initial money to invest or not, he has to take care of that. Fund to pay performance guarantee. Now performance guarantee is also another kind of security deposit that guarantees the contractor's performance or quality. So whether he has that money or not, he has to check. Resource mobilization. He is a contractor from Bangalore and he has to work in Rourkela. So how is he going to shift the man, material, money and machinery from Bangalore to Rourkela? He has to look into that. Next is checking essential infrastructure at the site, like supply of water, electricity, managing temporary shelter for the worker, repairing and maintenance of the machinery, whether those are possible at the site or not. He checks all those. Next is completion of any other pre-contract activities specific to site. So from the contractor's site also, or the bidder's site also, he does a pre-contract check. Okay. For example, say you are asking him to make the upper floor. So he'll go and check the stability of the slab of the lower floor, the roof slab of the lower floor, whether it is strong, whether it is okay, whether you can drill through that or not. He checks everything and then goes. So these are pre-contract activities which a contractor needs to check also. And any particular problem or guideline applicable to the site zone. So initially when the first part of the house was built, it was a different zone. Now it is now a heritage zone. So with what kind of problem the contractor will face, he has to look into that beforehand. Okay. So this is a specimen tender notice. Okay, I will show you a different one which you would be more familiar with. Okay, Rohit, can you see a Word file?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I hope others can also see.
Presenting the tender heading.
No, a Word file. National Institute of Technology, Rourkela, limited tender inquiry.
Yes,
no,
sir.
Word file. That is not visible.
It's not visible.
No, sir. So it's not visible, sir. Sir, it's not visible.
It is not visible, okay. Again, let me share. Is it visible now?
Yes, sir. Now, yes.
For Rohit, since he is accessing mobile and using mobile data, mobile internet, it will take a 3 to 4 second delay. Okay, let me quickly browse through. This is a tender invitation, limited tender inquiry. So first of all, it is not a negotiated tender, it is not an open tender, it is a limited tender. So we will be sending it to limited number of bidders only. Okay. So secondly, it comes with a letterhead. That means the authority inviting, tender inviting authority's name is mentioned. So he or she might not be selling the product to me, but he might be willing to sell it to National Institute of Technology, Rourkela. And the department's name is also mentioned and is here. So in this rectangular box inside, we would be writing the name to whom we are sending it. Beside that, some important dates and times are mentioned. Last date of submission of quotation is given, a date long back. The time is given, as well as quotation opening dates are also mentioned. These are those 11th and 12th point of information in the tender notice. Then we say, dear sir, we intend to purchase this particular commodity as per specifications and terms and conditions given letter. So you give your price quotation. Please send your quotation to the following address I am giving. And this tender invitation notice is being sent by me also. So in this particular case, both the addresses are same. So I, on behalf of this authority, am inviting this tender. Okay. And it also has an enclosure. Let's find out what is there in the enclosure. This is a tender invitation notice, bear with it. Schedule of requirement. We need 37 number of 8 GB RAM for desktop and 37 number of graphics cards for desktop. This is the brief description. Next shows this detailed description of the product. Now you see, I have this because this was a wrong tender invitation, because we have mentioned, I have highlighted something. We have mentioned some given brands. which we could, which we should not have done. Hence, it got rejected. Okay. So somebody who is having some other, say, Zebronic RAM and all, they could not compete. So the components, the description, the specification should have been so critical that these two companies would have competed only. Okay. Next is specification, detailed specifications are given. This third point is format of quotation. Now this quotation means format of submitting the tender. So either it can be a single bid or a twin bid. The quotation can be either single bid, that means one bid which includes the specification as well as the price cost. So the technical bid and the financial bid are together. So it is a single bid. Please give all technical specifications and price bid in one envelope. In one envelope only, we find all the specification as well as the financial bid. So the quotation, price quotation. Now in complicated cases, where you have to check first the detail configuration and then you have to go to check the price, we can ask for two stage bid also. So one is a techno-commercial bid and the other is a price bid. So first, only if the techno-commercial bid, say 100 people have submitted the bids. So just we don't need not compare everybody's price. We will just compare the techno-commercial, technical and commercial aspects of the bids first, and then reject most of them, whichever doesn't qualifies with our requirement. And whoever qualifies, we only open the price bid of those people. Okay. Can others please mute if you are not using your mic? Thank you. Now this is the descriptive bid document, we call. So the bid envelope should be superscribed with the details that I have given, so that there will be a lot of envelope coming up. Which of them is for which bid or which tender, to know that it is superscribed by the information that RAM and graphics card by inquiry number of a particular date. It also should mention the period of validity of the quotation. So inside that, the price that he is quoting, there should be a validity of that. Again, some important dates are mentioned. So if I am a bidder, I have just received this mail from an authority. I have to first see what the terms and conditions have been kept in front of me before I submit the quotation. All the taxes details are given in here, excise duty, VAT, which has now been scrapped to GST only, entry tax, bids, bid security. So this is the security deposit. So since we are purchasing from some reliable bidders only, and it is a limited bidder, we know that everybody of them are secured bidder or are willing bidder. So we say nil, you don't have to submit anything. No bid security, no money has to be paid. Performance security or performance bond. Again, it is nil. Because we are assured that we are sending it to only those bidder who will give the price, and if they are given a contract, if they are given a contract, they would be willingly giving good products. So their performance is guaranteed. So we have put it nil again. Here you would have given, say, 5,000 rupees, 10,000 rupees, and there is no limit to that. But it should be having some parity with the estimated cost of money. To what should be there in the envelope and all is given. Now we have the bid condition or bid document, where all the instructions are given, that how much money, where should it be given, what should not be done, if there is a discrepancy, how it has to be tackled, in what format or in what unit the price should be given. We clearly say that there should not be any overwriting of any money, or else if there is overwriting, you are not going to take the lowest, you are just going to scrap it, disqualify it. Overwriting is good enough a criteria for disqualification of tender. Okay. So these are available in your institute website, but after I complete the tender, I will share with this. I will share with you this particular thing. So very quickly, just now presenting the tender. This is a bid document is being submitted by the bidder. So the tender is checked to avoid mistakes before presenting. Hence, we expect a last moment submission of this tender, so that all the mistakes are taken care of. Next is signed and put into a sealed envelope. Now, whether it has been like the form that I have just now shown, I have not signed in that. It has to be manually signed or digitally signed, and then only it has to be put inside the envelope. That is a guarantee that the presenter should check, or the bidder has to check this. The envelope has written on top of it the title of the project and last date of submission. Now, title of the project is important because suppose multiple projects or multiple bids have been invited for multiple part of a construction work. So this envelope is relevant to which? That should be identified from the title of the project, as well as the last date of submission has to be mentioned, because suppose you have sent it through a courier and the courier is unnecessarily delaying it because your fate is lying in the courier person's hand. So if the last date of submission is mentioned and it is within the capability of the courier person, it has to reach and it has to be reached or delivered by the courier person on time before the last date. Okay. The tender is addressed to a proper authority and endorsed with the name of the contractor. So on your envelope, there should be whoever is submitting the tender, his authority, as well as the name of the contractor. It is expected. So you just have a rubber stamp. You just put that rubber stamp on the envelope. So you beside two, you write the bidding or the tender inviting authority's name, and from you write the tenderer's authority's name. And accompanying the proposal, but usually in a separate envelope, is a challan or a check for earnest money. So earnest money is never put inside the quotations envelope, because suppose I have asked for 5,000 rupees of earnest money and you have put 6,000 rupees, and that 1,000 extra is to convince me to accept yours as the lowest bidder. So to avoid that, earnest money is given in a separate envelope. Okay, so let's keep it for today. We will meet on Friday evening. Okay, so you all can come up with any questions if you want.